time for us all to draw closer to Jesus.
You ever get the feeling that people like to be here? You notice when we walk in here in the morning and people start to filter in? They're quick to say good morning. They're quick to extend a hand. They slap you on the back. It's kind of a lighthearted presence. I feel that when I'm here. I really truly do. And this morning, that presence is here this morning. I mean, we're friends. And it shows. Could bow our head, please. Heavenly Father, today, Lord, is your day. We come to you as your children, as believers in the teachings of Jesus Christ.
led by the Holy Spirit. The words that are spoken today, Lord, in this teaching, let us seal them. Allow those words to be sealed in our heart, and at the proper time be shared with friends and neighbors. Help us, Lord, to be the farmers that you desire us to be, to plant those seeds. We thank you so much, Lord, for giving us the privilege and the opportunity to spread the gospel, to have it taught to us, to share in the camaraderie of the Christian brotherhood. Without fear, without having to look over our shoulders and wonder who might be listening. This is your time, Lord, and this is your place, and we are yours. Help us, Lord, to live the dream that you have planted in our hearts. It's in your name only, Lord, we will always pray. Amen. Amen. And now we can say good morning again.
Thank you. Amen. You can be seated. Do you believe there's power in the blood?
Amen. I used to sing with a Southern Gospel Quartet. If we said power, our lead singer did that. It's power. Heaven power. And he was from Dallas, Texas. He used to sing with people many years ago. Homer Tankersley. You can look up Homer online. He was here. We sang together for 15 years. It was a joy to be with Homer. This last year they were here. He's 80. How old is he? He's old. He's old. Nice to know. Hey, let's send the kids to Children's Church. We have a hard time getting him to go. Hi, O'Neal. See you later. I remember we used to have children's church and we didn't work it. No, not yet. We're working on that. Go ahead and run the announcements for me, Mr. Jerry. Sunday evening, tonight I will not be preaching on Saving Faith because tonight is Fifth Sunday Sing. I've had a lot of requests about singing tonight, and I'll probably go ahead and sing anyways. But Roger's preaching on Isaiah in Sunday school. Mike's teaching on how to make right choices, or how to make choices you won't regret. Ladies' Bible study is Tuesdays at 9:30. Renee's teaching on Lord, I Want to Know You. The January missionary focus has been on All the King's Horses Children's Ranch. Next week, Brother Gary is going to speak to us about his ministry at the AM service for a little while. We're just offering up ideas to buy things even now for Operation Christmas Child, so we'll have more boxes next year than ever before. Tonight's the fifth Sunday sing. Bring your old cell phones and ink cartridges. If you're going to bring them in a hurry because we're going to mail them off on the 31st. There is a special men's breakfast on next Saturday. Men. Next Saturday at 7:30 at Galliano's, okay? All right? So be there. Hospitality meeting team will meet after the AM service next week. Wendy's is a lot of food stuff. Wendy's is next Sunday night. Elders meeting on Monday the 6th at 6. Children's ministry, we're going to meet. We're going to meet after the AM service on the 12th. And then the regular men's breakfast is postponed a week to the 18th because the 11th is Valentine's weekend. And we know you probably want to do something special for your wife on the 11th. Right, wives?
Yes.
Okay. What is that, Friday?
Oh, sorry, that's games night.
Oh, that's games night. We're going to have a games night on Friday, February 24th at 6 p.m. for adults and children, and everybody in between. And then we need a VBS director for the 19th through 23rd of June for Operation Arctic. And you know, the way I feel about it, if God doesn't provide a director, then we won't do it. But he's always provided a director, so. Here's some things. Miles Choate, who's at Marine Basic Training. His address is in here if you want to drop him a card. Number 10 envelope only, please. His recruit mate who's with him, who he's been speaking to about the Lord, his address is in there. You can just send him some scripture to encourage him. Jackie Burkholder, Stoney and Jackie live just down the street over there. She's been ill. You can send her a card of encouragement. Karen Meyer usually sits right there where Joyce Morton is in the PM service. Karen just had hip replacement. You can send her a card too, you know that? Okay? What else? What do you guys want to do now? I know you all want to hear my jokes.
My goal for 2016 was to lose 10 pounds. I only have 15 to go. This is how you prepare tofu. Throw it in the trash and grill some meat. I just did a week's worth of cardio after walking into a spider web. I got a million of them, but I'll save a few of them. The young guys back here aren't laughing, you know. They don't want to laugh. All right, let me see what I'm doing. Our who?
Yeah. Health and wellness.
Yes, I am. I'm into health and wellness. Yes. All right. You ready? All right. So last week, when we closed the lesson we were looking at last week, we were looking at the Jews' questioning of John the Baptist. We're in John 1. This is our eighth lesson in the book of John. It took us 263 lessons to teach the book of Romans. I'm estimating 315 for the book of John. So I'll be here for a while. I don't know about you. But we were looking at how the Jews came to John the Baptist, sent by the Sanhedrin, and they asked him, "Who are you? Are you the Christ? Are you Elijah? Are you the prophet?" And we discussed the Jews' concern. What generated their questioning was they were mainly concerned about their power and their authority. They wanted to make sure they wouldn't lose either of those two things. We also saw John's response. We began to speak to that last week. John said he was a voice, remember? He was a voice declaring to ready the way for the Lord. And he wasn't the one that they needed to focus on. He was trying to get them to focus on the one that was among them, but the one that they did not yet know. All right? So, I'm still kind of congested, but we're going to get through this. John 1:19. We're going to start in John 1:19. And so let's put aside the things of the world. Don't worry about lunch. Don't worry about the bills you got to pay next week. Let's give God his due for the next 30 to 35 minutes. John 1:19. If you're ready for the word of God, would you signify that by saying amen? And would you stand with me out of respect for the reading of the word of God, which is a lamp unto our feet? John 1:19. Now this is the testimony of John. When the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" he confessed and did not deny, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, that was probably First Baptist Tucson that offered me a job. That's okay. Tell him I'm busy. And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." And then they asked, "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you, that we may give an answer to those who sent us? What do you say about yourself?" And he said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now those who were sent were from the Pharisees, and they asked him, saying, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, saying, he doesn't really answer them. He says, "I baptize with water, but there stands one among you whom you do not know. It is he who, coming after me, is preferred before me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose." These things were done in Bethabara, really Bethany, beyond the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who is preferred before me, for he was before me.' I do not know him, but that he should be revealed to Israel, therefore I come baptizing with water. And John bore witness, saying, 'I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and he remained upon him. I did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, Upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on
him, this is he who baptized with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen and testified that this is the Son of God. Again, the next day, John stood with his two disciples, and looking at Jesus as he walked, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. And Jesus turned, and seeing them following, said to them, "What do you seek?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which is to say, when translated, "teacher, where are you staying?" And he said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying and remained with him that day. Now it was about the 10th hour. Thank you. You can be seated. Okay. So I want to stress the facts, as the scripture stresses the facts, that John the Baptist did have the authority to baptize with water. As it says in verse 33 there, he says, "He who sent me to baptize said to me," he, that would be God, okay? So God had told John, he who sent me to, what John said to him, "He who sent me to baptize, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining upon him, this is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit." John the Baptist came to baptize with water, and John would be then exposed to the one who would come to baptize with the Holy Spirit, pointing towards the Son of God. And that is, those words there are written in the past tense. So John is giving us his recollection of what happened when he baptized Jesus Christ. So this picture, these three successive days in Scripture are written in the past tense in the Greek. He did what he did. John the Baptist did what he did because John told him to do it, or God told him to do it. Okay, and he doesn't tell him much at the moment. What he tells him, you know, they ask him the question, right? He says, "How do you have this authority to baptize?" Does he answer the question? No, he doesn't. What he says is, "You don't look at me. Don't worry about what I'm doing. What you need to do is look at the one who's coming." He deflects all of the attention from himself to Jesus Christ. You need to look at the one who is going to baptize with the Holy Spirit. You need to be more concerned about that. You need to be worried about real baptism, real purification, real regeneration. Okay? That's going to be the work of the Messiah. And he is here, and you're going to come to know him, and he's going to baptize with the Holy Spirit. That's at the end of that 33rd verse. So John, as I said, does here what he does throughout his ministry. John the Baptist always turns everybody's attention towards Jesus Christ, okay? And there you have the first message. In verse 26, it says, "There stands one among you whom you do not know." John's telling them, Jesus is already here, but you don't know him. So that's his first message. Remember I told you there are three messages given to three groups of people on three consecutive days. The first day, the first message is, he's here. And John is speaking to the group of men that are assembled from the Sanhedrin who have come to question him. On day number two, his message is, behold him. And in that message, he is speaking to anybody that hears him. Behold him. And on the third day, the last day of this narrative, he tells some people, follow him. And those people he says to follow him are his own disciples. Follow him. Okay? And it's important that we understand that that's the way the sequence takes place. Those are the messages that are spoken here. One is already here that you don't know, but he's the one that you need to be concerned about. He's the one that's going to baptize with the Holy Spirit. He's the one that deals with the heart. Okay? Does baptism save? Is there anything mystical about that water? No. What's mystical, what's beyond our understanding, is the regeneration that happens within us when we come to know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. The water is just a symbol of our desire to be in obedience to the Lord. And the Messiah has arrived, he tells them. He's in the land, and the fact he's walking. At that very moment, as John speaks these words to this group of
Levites and priests who are come from the Sanhedrin, Jesus is walking towards John. He's still a little ways away, but he's coming to John. He's going to arrive the next day. Jesus, John baptized Jesus, how long ago? 40 days. Where'd Jesus go after he was baptized? He went to Benson, Arizona. He went to the wilderness. Okay? He's been out in that wilderness for 40 days being tempted of Satan. Satan winning victory over Satan. Jesus was 100% man, right? And 100% God, right? Shake your heads, yes. And he's been tempted just like me and you, hasn't he? Has he been able to overcome that temptation? Why do you think that that's in the Bible? So you know, you can overcome those temptations too. Are you going to succeed all the time? If you figure it out, let me know. If I can't, I haven't been able to. But if the ability to do it is there. All we have to do is dwell on the Lord. And what John is saying here is that Jesus has been identified and he's present. And that's the first great message here. That lady's, and do you know what? I could stop right now. You know what? I could just stop right here. You know why? Because that's the gospel. You know what? He's here. What more do you want? You want me to beg you? You want me to cajole you? I had a tooth extracted last week. You want me to pull your teeth? That'll get you. He's here. And listen, when you get to heaven, and you stand before Christ, and you say, well, I didn't know, or I didn't understand, it's my prayer that Jesus Christ will tell you, well, you were at New Life Family Worship in Palm Reed, Arizona. You knew. That's why we give an invitation every week. It's important. See, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior today, guess whose fault it is? It's yours. It's really yours. And the Word teaches us that everyone knows. Everybody, everywhere, no matter where they're at. So the Jews had come with a desire. Their desire, they were eager to expose anyone who proclaimed to be a Messiah. And there were a lot of false messiahs at that time in history. Because the Jews' concern was to make sure that they were always elevated amongst everybody else. And remember, when I use the term the Jews, which John uses 70 times in the Gospel of John, I'm speaking about the derogatory term that he used to speak about the Jewish leadership. But the Jews were eager to expose false messiahs and make sure that they were elevated above these other people. And they were so eager, they were so desirous of doing that, when their own Messiah showed up, they couldn't figure it out. And you outline the word is Messiah. And John the Baptist says, you don't need to be concerned about me. I'm just the voice. I'm the slave. Okay? Remember, he describes himself as not being worthy of tying or unloosing the thong of Jesus or untying it. The reason why is because that's the lowest job in the house. The lowest slave got to untie thongs and wash feet. John says, I'm not worthy to do that for this particular individual whose name is Jesus. So what I want to tell you this morning, I've already mentioned this twice because I get stuff stuck in my head. I've mentioned this a couple times already this morning. See, I'm not what's important here. Really, there isn't a preacher anywhere that's important. What's important here is the one that the preacher's talking about. Yeah. That's what's important here. Okay? Don't get wrapped up around the preacher. Get wrapped up about who the preacher's talking about. That's what you need to be wrapped up about. So on the first day, then, we see John's first testimony to this group from the Sanhedrin. And he says he's here. And as soon as John said those words, as soon as that group of people left John the Baptist, they would have gone immediately back to Jerusalem, and guess what? Everybody in the elite leadership of Jerusalem would have known exactly what John the Baptist said. They would have known that they would have said, John the Baptist told us that the Messiah is already here. That's a revolutionary thought. So the Sanhedrin, all the elite leaders of Israel, would have known from that moment on, even though Jesus Christ has not yet begun his public ministry, they would have known, they would have been told, the Messiah is here. So they don't have an excuse either, do they? They couldn't say that they were surprised that Jesus had shown up and claimed to be the Messiah. They had already been told that somebody had, that the Messiah was there. They were already on notice that the Messiah was coming and that he had arrived, okay? And so the hostility of the elite church leaders, was that not the church of Israel? The hostility of the church leaders of Israel at that time begins at this moment as they are told that the Messiah is here, and it goes all the way to the cross of Jesus Christ. They knew, they didn't like it, and they were going to make sure that he didn't succeed. Okay? That's the first message. He's here. Okay, day two. Day two picks up on verse 29. Like I told you, I'm a theologian. I know day two is on verse 29 because it says in the next day. So in verse 28, it tells us where everything happened. It said it was in Bethany. If your Bible says Bethabeta, that's wrong. That's a man putting in a word because he didn't understand there was more than one Bethany. It happened in Bethany, down to the south across the Jordan. We know John the Baptist needed one thing to baptize people. Water. He was out in the wilderness on the other side of the Jordan River. In verse 29 says it's the next day, and John sees Jesus coming, right? He baptized him 40 days ago. Jesus is now 41 days ago. Now Jesus is coming back, and he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Day two. Second group. All the people are gathered there. It's a proclamation, a public proclamation. Behold him. Message one, he's here. Message two, behold him. Why should you behold him? Well, because he's the Lamb of God. He's the Lamb of God. Day one was a private declaration to the members of the Sanhedrin. Day two is a public proclamation, if you will. And it's a shock. John sees Jesus coming, and he knows him, obviously. And he declares him to be the Lamb of God. Behold. What's that mean? Look. Exactly. Look. Take him in. Take in the reality of who this is. He is here. He is the Lamb of God. Now, do you think the people were happy to hear about the Lamb of God? Nope. You know why? Who wants a Messiah that's a lamb? I don't want a Messiah that's a lamb. You know, what's a lamb? Weak, helpless, not real bright, dependent upon others, correct? I would imagine some of them said, "What do you mean the Messiah is a lamb?" That's actually shocking news. They would have expected John the Baptist to say, "Behold, here comes your king." Or maybe, "Behold, the triumphant one. Behold, the one, the majestic one, the exalted one, the ruler, the anointed one." But he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God." What are lambs? Lambs are sacrificial animals. Every Jew, when he thinks of a lamb, thinks of a sacrifice. They were sacrificed all the time. Through the centuries, Israel knew about sacrificing lambs. Go all the way back to Abraham and his son Isaac, when God provided a substitute, a sacrifice for Abraham so he didn't have to sacrifice his own son. All the way back to Exodus, the Passover lamb, the Passover, the meal Every morning, every evening, there were lamb sacrifices daily at the temple. You know how many? Do you know what the estimate is of the lambs that were sacrificed at Passover? Josephus estimates 250,000 lambs. Do you know? And they were executed in two places: the king of the court of the priest, in one of the other courts, about a little bit over 100 feet long, 18 feet wide. And on each side of the altars where they slaughtered these lambs, there were these large troughs. And they said the troughs ran with blood all that time as they sacrificed lamb after lamb after lamb. When the people heard that their Messiah was a lamb, they had to be shocked. They had read Isaiah 53 that said that he was a lamb led to slaughter, the one who was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities, and the one whom on the chastening of our peace fell. They knew all of that, but they never understood. They knew there was a sacrifice, but they didn't know how the sacrifice plays into it. They didn't know how it fit because, listen, if you're all right, you don't need a sacrifice. So you might be sitting here today and you think, I'm all right. I don't need a sacrifice. And that's what the people of Israel were convinced. They didn't need no sacrifice. They were good enough just the way they were. So if you don't need a sacrifice, do you need a lamb? You don't need no lamb. You got everything under control. I'm okay, you're okay, it's all right. It's going to be all right. Be a good person. That's what the world wants you to believe. Be a good person. One of the most striking images in the Bible is in Revelation 5. The Apostle John, on the island of Patmos, is given a vision where he's transported to heaven. And in Revelation 5, there is bemoaning that there is no one worthy to open the scrolls. And you know who shows up? The Lamb. And you know who he is? He's a lamb. In the Greek, it's very explicit. He is a little lamb. And he has been killed. He has been murdered. He has within him the wounds that he took for me and you. That lamb that John saw in that vision is this lamb who is coming to his people now in the New Testament. The lamb who is worthy to take the scrolls, and in the taking of the scrolls, he inaugurates the recovery of the entire universe back to its proper position. See, you can get enamored with this world. You can get enamored with a church building. You know some folks? They don't matter what you teach them. You know, mama and daddy, they're buried in the back graveyard. You can ask them, are you safe? Yeah, my parents are buried here. Whatever that means. See, all of this, everything. This is a facade. This is temporary. This matters nothing. This is eternal. This is going somewhere. It's going there, or it's going to end up in a completely different place. That's reality. The Word says that the things of the spiritual world are the real things of life. That's what you have to be concerned about. So Jesus, when he opens that scroll, he begins to reinstate everything that's been backwards. Why do you think right is wrong and wrong is right today? Let me ask you, is right wrong today? Is wrong, and is right, you know what I mean, backwards and forwards? We are so concerned about hugging trees that we're killing babies. That's who we are. That's who we become in today's society. 60 million children have been killed in the womb. And think of that. You saw those kids today. Those are wonderful gifts from the Lord.
Amen.
God. But these folks, and I want you to know that there's not a lot of difference between those folks that I call these folks and folks today. These folks were sure that the combination of their righteousness and their obedience because they sacrificed something was enough to keep them in the good graces of God. And people do that still today. They think, I'm good enough, and I'm going to give God whatever I want to give him. It might be some of my time. It might be some of my money. It might be some of my work. And God doesn't want any of it unless you have a personal relationship with him. If you don't have that relationship, that's all trash. Rubbish. It means a lot more than that, but I won't get any more explicit. But the animals, the sacrifice that that they did all the time, over and over and over again, was something that could not take away their sins. The one who was coming was the one who could take away their sin. But they could never recognize their own sinfulness, and they could never recognize the truth that they were under judgment, and that they were under the wrath of God, just as we are today. They could never understand that they needed a real sacrifice. They could never understand Isaiah 53. They have no concept that before you can have a Messiah king, you first have to have a Messiah lamb. Before you can be, listen, Christians, before you can be exalted as a child of God, you need to be willing to get on your knees and accept him as your Lord and Savior first. That's the first thing. Then you'll be exalted as a child of God. Behold, John says, behold the Lamb of God, the Lamb of God, the Lamb. You know, when the families used to sacrifice, they had to take that baby lamb into their house for, I think, 3 days. You think the kids got associated with that lamb? Boy, you better know it. They probably loved those little baby lambs. And then they had to take that lamb to the temple and sacrifice it. God chose someone he was very associative with. His own son, and sent him to die for me and you. He was chosen to be our sacrifice. He was chosen to come and deal with sin for one last time. He was chosen to deal with our transgressions. He was chosen to be sin for me and you. He who knew no sin became sin for us. He was offered up as a sacrifice on the cross. He bore our sins in his own body. God made him who knew no sin to be sin for you and for me. You can say hallelujah.
Amen.
The Jews wanted a prophet. The Jews wanted a king. And what did they get? They got a lamb. The Jews wanted a leader. They wanted a monarch. And what did they get? They got a substitute. They wanted an exalted Messiah. They received someone who was a humiliated sacrifice on the cross. The Jews wanted someone who would kill their enemies, and they got somebody who their enemies killed. Perfect God logic. God is always, almost always, opposite of the way we think we are. Or he is when we think in our own mind rather than understand who he is in the way he is. They could never have a king until they had a lamb. And that's the two comings that the Jews have never understood. They could never understand that first coming, that he would come in a humble form to be humiliated and die. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.
In the whole world, there's only one who can take away that sin. And that's the one who died the sacrificial death as a lamb for you and me. The death that we accept. And John then adds in verse 30, he says the same thing that he said in 15. The same thing that he said in verse 27 in our source text. He says, "This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who is preferred or of higher rank before me, for he was before me." And again, he's saying, don't look at me, look at him. Okay? Look at him first. So get your eyes off of me and think about the one that we're talking about. Get your eyes on the exalted one, who's, John says, he's of a higher rank, he's preferred. And John's, again, he deflects, still teaching. And he says in verse 31, he says, "I didn't know him or recognize him." Now you might say, well, how's that? How come John didn't recognize him? Weren't Elizabeth and Mary related? Were they related? Yes, they were related. Didn't they talk to each other? Come on now. Two women out there in the countryside, I'm sure they talk to each other a little bit. Did Mary know that she had conceived the Son of God without a human father? Did Elizabeth know that she had been given an immaculate pregnancy, if you will? Okay. Do you think they talked about those things through the years? Do you think they ever told their sons about those things? I think they did, in my humble but accurate opinion. I think they knew exactly who their mothers were. I think they knew exactly what their mothers had been told upon visitation from God's angels. They would certainly know, I think the family knew what was going on. But remember what has happened. Well, Jesus has been a carpenter for the past 25 years. He hasn't been in the limelight for 30 years. And John's saying, he's the Son of God. He's God in human flesh. He's the Messiah, which John's saying. But has Jesus led a resurrection and overtaken the country away from the Romans? No. So do you think it might be easy for John to doubt John the Baptist? Yeah, it might be. You know, even after all of this transpires, even after Jesus begins his public ministry, even after all that happens, do you know that John the Baptist still doubted? Yes, he did. He sent his disciples to Jesus, and you know what he told his disciples to ask Jesus? Are you the Messiah? Are you the Messiah? And then we wonder why our faith is so feeble sometimes. That's why you need to pray for faith. You need to exercise your faith. It's like a muscle. You don't use it. It atrophies. But John ended up sending his disciples to Jesus. And they went to Jesus and said, John wants to know. Are you really the Messiah? You haven't done. It's as if they're saying you haven't done anything yet. You haven't overthrown these Romans. You haven't done this or that. And you know what Jesus tells John's disciples? Tell them what I've done. Tell them about my works. Actually, John uses the word in the Greek for this. Tell them about my signs. You know what a sign does? It points the way. John's very purposeful. He never uses the word for miracles in the Greek. He always says, look at the signs. John says, I didn't know him. I didn't recognize him. The word in the Greek is oida. O-I-D-A. Oida. It means to understand, to perceive. It means to deeply perceive. Kataleves is to understand. It means to, oida means to perceive, to have an inner understanding. Even John the Baptist had his questions. So you can understand how people will say about the apostles, well, those apostles, they were such foolish people. They lived with Jesus and they still didn't know what was going on. Hey, this is revolutionary stuff going on here. Alright? So, it's important for us to see, and one thing I want to stress here, that even as John the Baptist, who knew all of these things about Jesus, he knew these things about himself. When Jesus showed up, did John the Baptist say, oh, that's the Son of God?
he didn't understand who that was until the scripture tells us what happened, until he saw the Spirit descend upon him. And then it was clear to him for a while, because later on he still questioned it. But so did Jesus walk up and he had a halo? No. When Jesus walked up in your outline, there was nothing that seeing Jesus would tell you that he was a heavenly person. As I said, he's 100% man. He's 100% God. Okay? In Luke 3 and Matthew 3, it says, God says, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And John heard those words. But even after hearing those words, John still had doubts. So I want to help you today. I want to make sure that you understand two things. We looked at 2 days. I've got more material, but I'm going to stop here. I want you to understand two things today. He's here, and I want you to behold him. He's here, and I want you to behold him. And that's the ministry of John the Baptist. That's the ministry of any teacher, preacher. That's the gospel message. John had seen the Spirit coming down. And I think if John the Baptist believed, I think we can believe that he's a credible voice for us to believe. He's here. Behold the Lamb of God who's come to take away the sins of the world. You know, the Word tells us that God desires that everyone be saved. Really, he does. But you know what happens? You hear it over, and you hear it over, and you harden your heart. And you know what happens with hard hearts? After a while, God says, Pharaoh hardened his heart. And you know what he did next time? He hardened his heart. And you know what happened the next time? He continued to harden his heart. You know what happened the last time? God hardened his heart. See, you may have been taught that grace is never ending. Grace has its limitations. God already knows your final destination. The question you have to ask yourself is, do I? Pray with me. Please stand. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for your word, Lord. We want to thank you for the opportunity to examine your word. We want to thank you, Lord, that you're here today. And Lord, we just want to welcome you into our midst. Lord, even as we began this morning and Brother Mike spoke about the Spirit that was here, we recognize, Lord, that we're very fortunate to be able to feel your power amongst us. How, Lord, we're able to put ourselves aside and let you take control. And Lord, that's my prayer for each and every one of us today. Lord, I was struck today, this morning, Lord. I was dwelling on the sermon. I was thinking, Lord, how when I was 38 years old, it was as if you touched me on the shoulder and said, "It's time." How I was sitting way back in the back of that sanctuary right next to that aisle so I could get out of there as fast as I could. So I could get away. And you wouldn't let me get away. You just kept loving me. I didn't understand that love. Lord, I remember getting out of that chair in the back of that sanctuary.
I never thought my feet touched the ground, and it was a long way. But you were there every step of that way. Lord, it's our prayer this morning. If there's anyone here that does not know you as their personal Lord and Savior, that this would be the day. And if that's your condition, you don't have to wait. You don't have to wait for a song to be sung, for a mouth to be opened, for a note to be played. You can just come up here and proclaim to everybody here that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. Lord, forgive us. Forgive us in our failures. Forgive us for our pride. Whatever the circumstances of our life might be today, Lord, we give them to you. Lord, if there's those here today that are touched by your Spirit for saving grace, we so appreciate that. If there's those here today, Lord, that need to be scripturally baptized, pray they would come forward. If there's those that want to join in the membership of this body of believers, if there's those that just need to kneel at the altar, Lord, if there's those that need to speak to me or to speak to another elder or an elder's wife. But purify our hearts. Touch us in a special way today. We lift up our family and friends to you, Lord. Those that are still lost, we pray, Lord, we covenant your touch in their life. I just feel burdened for people today, Lord. I know that there are those here that know you well. So, Lord, we give this time to you. It's not about me. It's all about you. Just move amongst your people as you would move. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.